Hello everyone. First of all, welcome to the webinar hosted by PMS AIF World. A very good evening to all of you. Today we have amongst us Mr. Vikas Khemani, who is the founder and CEO with Carnelian Capital. Prior to, you know, founding Carnelian Capital, Mr. Khemani has been working with Edelweiss for 17 years. And, you know, he has spent there 17 years out of 22 years of his total experience. He is a chartered accountant and CFA chartered holder. He has established businesses within Edelweiss, businesses which pertain to equities, institutional equities and research. Within Carnelian, he's, you know, driving a portfolio management service as well as an alternative investment fund. The performance of the product is, you know, very good. So we would not cover about the performance of the product, but in general, we would like to cover in this session, you know, the views of Mr. Vikas Khemani about the markets. Currently, we are in unprecedented times. We have spoken a lot about, you know, why one should be investing for long term, and, you know, what are the challenges and what are the opportunities in the current context. However, in current context, one reality is that investors are really, really worried about the rising markets, as because the reality of economy is different. You know, or most of the investors who are especially long-term informed investors who would kind of invest after doing a lot of research are today unable to understand that, you know, why markets are kind of behaving different to what is being perceived largely. So this is you know, one point of confusion, which is what we would want this session to be all about. And, you know, within this, we would also want Vikas to highlight, you know, how one should be investing in such turbulent times. Over to you, Vikas. Thank you so much.
Hi, Kamal. Thank you very much for organizing this session. You know, compliments to PMS and AIF World for being sort of a platform to create awareness amongst the investors community and to sort of impart and enhance their knowledge through various sessions. And I've been seeing how you've been organizing over the, you know, over last couple of months. So compliments to you and your entire team. And it's again a pleasure to be amongst all of you to share and present my views, how I think. And I think it's very, very apt and relevant that, you know, how things right now are panning out. 2 months ago, all of us were worried about, you know, markets going down. It was collapsing, and I think probably the worry was that is there more to come. I remember when it was around 7,000, most people were predicting around 6,000, and, you know, and market, contrary to most people's expectation, came back very fast. So I think markets are very, very unpredictable. Markets are very difficult mechanism to predict, and one should never try to predict anything in the market. One should only try to sort of decipher what's the reality, what's happening, what markets are telling you, and what are the various possible paths. I mean, that's all you can do. So I don't claim to have any specific knowledge of how markets are going to behave. We all can try to understand what's happening in the market and getting some sense out of that. What are the various probabilistic outcomes, and you try to bet on the high probability outcome. I mean, that's all one can do. So, you know, let me come back to the topic straight. Very obvious questions to everybody's mind is that, you know, all of us, I've heard enough about this is, you know, unprecedented crisis, once in 100 years or maybe more kind of crisis. It is even bigger than some of the past crises, because this time around, you know, there's a supply side and demand side shock both, right? In the past, something like global financial crisis, we have had shocks only which are demand side, but this time we have seen from both sides. In the past, job losses have been less. This time around, job losses have been extremely high. So what is it that, you know, after the sell-off, especially if you look at the US markets and all, which has regained pretty much lost ground, almost back to, you know, pre-COVID level or very close to those levels. So, you know, what is it that markets are seeing, what others or common people are not able to see? So I think, you know, it's very important to understand what has happened. So I think obviously we saw market crack, a lot of selling happened in month of March as the COVID crisis and lockdown news spread out. So I think markets always get sold off for two reasons. One is the extreme sense of fear and panic, and secondly, want of liquidity. And these are the only two reasons why markets or asset prices get sold by investors or people at large. And in the month of March, we saw it started with a fear and panic. And as the news flows kept on getting bad, you know, asset prices fell, and it eventually resulted into kind of liquidity crisis. A lot of investors who were leveraged, kind of had to sell out. And this is what led to a sharp and sudden sell on the market. Now, let's look at what happened after, March end crash. What has happened in different parts of the world over the last 2 months? One, of course, health crisis has been escalating. It's not that we have had some sort of plateauing in some part of the country. Countries like India, we are seeing increasing numbers. Countries like US, we are seeing increasing numbers. So our health crisis has not receded. Still we have not found an answer or vaccine to combat that crisis. But economic crisis has been, a lot has been done to at least address the economic crisis. And a lot is being done to address the health crisis separately, but I think that is likely to take time. And probably, you know, we will see over a period of time, different solutions would come, and that also will settle down. But it is important to understand crisis always escalates, whether it is health crisis or economic crisis, always escalates when everybody is caught off guard. Once people are prepared to fight it out, typically recovery starts, right? Or typically, once collectively everybody works out to sort of fight it out. So this is precisely happening. Health crisis, I think, best of the brains, best of the organizations, governments across the globe are fighting. And I'm sure soon, some solutions have been found out, but soon there will be a lot more permanent solutions to control this crisis. But on the economic side, if you see across the globe, whether it is, US government or federal bank, or whether it is Germany or, ECB or UK and, UK Central Bank, Bank of England, or Japanese bank, so all large major economies have come out with a serious amount of stimulus, both fiscal as well as monetary stimulus. Now it's important to understand with some data points. Let us look at what has been done, and I will probably use a little bit one or two screenshots to kind of show you so that you get the right perspective. Just give me 1 minute. Well, I'm not able to share screen for some strange reasons, which were working some time ago.
Because you can meanwhile send the document to me, I will try.
I'm just trying. I think hopefully I should be able to get it.
Okay.
Can you see it?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I can see it. Sure.
So I think, I will try to showcase. I think, we spoke about various crises, and compared with different historical crises. But, why? It's very obvious question that why markets have fallen less, or why markets have recovered fast. Economy is off the cliff, but markets are still holding up. The real answer lies in the amount of stimulus which has been done by both, all the governments. And this is the data which shows that as compared to the global financial crisis or any other past crisis, the amount of money which is being pumped into the system, is fairly large, and large as in it's a multiplier of the past crisis, and still it is being done in a very aggressive manner. So as we speak, it is being increased. Now let us give us a small example. In global financial crisis, the Fed balance sheet went up from $1 trillion to $2 trillion in the next 4 months. Right now, in last post-crisis, so in April and May itself, Fed balance sheet has expanded $2.5 trillion, and the money supply has gone up by almost 25%. And importantly, the government has borrowed about $2.5 trillion and spent into the economy. And how are they spending? They are giving grants to a lot of individuals in the US. Households they are giving grants to businesses. They are so government is spending money. So when government is spending money, money is actually going in the hands of businesses, individuals, across the board. And that money is, when you have, as I was saying, that the crisis happens when there is either crisis of liquidity or fear. So the crisis of liquidity has gone away. A lot of money, people have got money in their hands. And as a result of that, there's no urgency or need for anybody to sell assets, or they have enough money in their hands, whether it is businesses or individual, to either fund their consumption or, run their businesses. There are many schemes which, Fed has come out with, where they are giving loans to the small and medium enterprises, large businesses, where they're buying collateral-backed securities from the market. So enough and more is being done. And more importantly, this time around, unlike global financial crisis, we don't have a situation where banks are not broken. Banks' balance sheets are far better. Also, in global financial crisis, we had seen that individual household balance sheets were completely leveraged. They were leveraged to the extent of 1.5 times of their disposable income at a country level, which is right now almost at 94, 95, meaning there is net saving which is there rather than net leverage of a US household. So that, as a result of that, you don't see that kind of liquidity crisis or panic or impact on the demand. And that is a basic hypothesis being made, that this huge amount of money being spent together when government is spending money and Fed is expanding balance sheet. And this twin effect has not happened for a long, long time. Even in global financial crisis, while it happened initially, but then government stopped spending much money. And in this time around, government has very, very aggressively come and given money in the hands. And that is very important, that even, as the crisis is sort of unfolding and going on, people are not worried about survival. People are not worried about consumption, meeting their needs right now. And that is a very, very important. And same thing is being done, by the way, across various, as I was saying, in Germany, in UK, in France, in Japan, everywhere there are different kind of sizes which are implemented, where money is going into the system. And mind you, when this kind of money comes, it is very clear that right now liquidity is not a problem, but demand will come with a lag. And that is what the market is right now factoring in, that what demand collapse some of us are fearing will not be there in this time. And the lockdown halted the economy. As things starts working, slowly it will start getting back to normalcy. And that is what the right now real thing is. And there's an old saying in the market, don't fight Fed. When Fed government is doing something, Federal Bank is out there to fix something, don't fight that. You have to sort of live with that. And I think that is the very, very essential of all these things. And it sounds very simple to say that, because of liquidity, how can asset prices remain inflated? Actually, in shorter term, it is only liquidity which drives the asset prices, whether it is real estate, equities, bonds, or anything. If tomorrow a lot of money starts going to real estate, which, if you remember, had happened in case of US between 2003 to 2008, real estate prices went up 4 to 5x when Alan Greenspan had actually opened up the economy, banking system, to give leverage against the mortgages, and he had actually promoted banks to aggressively lend against the mortgages, and that had created the real estate market of probably a century. That kind of boom in real estate had not happened for a long, long time. So I think any time there's a liquidity abundance, either to a particular directed to an asset class or in general in the economy, you will see asset prices remaining solid, because there's no need for you to kind of liquidate or sell. And eventually that liquidity feeds into the fundamental. Just think about from a just a commonsensical perspective. You don't need to be an economist to do this. Suppose you are running a small business. Now that business, you are actually, suddenly COVID crisis hits, and you are running out without money because for 2 months you had to pay salary, you had to meet fixed costs, but there was no revenue. And you know, and as any small business or any business for that matter, you know, if you have to pay fixed costs, no revenue, there will be sudden shortfall of working capital. Now, let us think of a situation, somebody came and gave you that working capital, you will be able to revive the business very fast. You will say, okay, even if I have lost 2 months profitability, at least I am able to get back to business by getting the temporary liquidity. So if I, let's say somebody, a bank came and gave you, you know, 2 months working capital, say, why don't you sell? So you will be able to start a business and then that will get into your positive cycle. Now imagine a situation that you are not getting that liquidity. Since you did not get liquidity, you will not be able to come out of the bad cycle. Next month, you will not be able to do business. It will actually compound the problem. So hence, this is the positive loop of a liquidity which gets created on the businesses. And same way it works at the economy level when, you know, multiple businesses go through the same thing, individuals go through the same thing. So if you apply this, you don't need to be a very big economist to understand this. Just common sensically, if you apply at our own level and, you know, try to generalize at an economy level, you will understand. So this is what is precisely happening. Now the, and you know, these are some of the data, you know, which is there. So this is the crux of overall that, you know, we must understand, don't fight fad. And historically, whenever this has happened, I think markets have come out very well. Now, question is that if this is the case, of course, Indian markets have recovered, but India is still underperforming by and large. Okay. You know, that is, as compared to most markets and including developed markets and emerging markets. Why is that so? And the answer for that lies here. If you plot all countries on a, you know, two axes of stringency of lockdown index versus stimulus impact, right? There are countries like United States which had least or lesser stringent lockdown, but they had a very high stimulus. There are companies like Japan which were mild, you know, lockdown, but again mild stimulus. Countries like South Korea had a very stringent lockdown, but they had a very above average or very decent sort of stimulus. India is the only probably country where we have a very stringent lockdown, and still it's going on in some cases, some parts of the country. But we had a very low stimulus, and I think this is, you know, compounding our problem. And to make the matter worse, when we went into the crisis, our economy was already weak. Our banking sector was struggling. Our credit crisis was unfolding. Investment cycle was weak. So all of those were anyway, I mean, auto demands were weak. So I think all of those were anyway sort of at play. So we were pre-COVID only, we were looking for measures to recover the economy. To make the matter worse, this has kind of compounded. And I think combination of these two is actually, you know, making it a little bit more harder for India to sort of recover. So I would say India is underperforming for this reason. And hence, I think, you know, we have to understand that even if world economy comes back, you know, India will surely come back, because I think it's like this, that when the water level goes down higher, you know, everything, every part of the, you know, sort of lake or pond benefits. Same way, we will also benefit because of the global liquidity. But if we also had our own twin engine of fiscal and monetary stimulus, much bigger than what has been done, I think we would be far quicker to recover. Having said that, I'm not saying the government is still doing a lot and it's a work in progress. So things can change overnight, things can change tomorrow when government and RBI is actually proactively working on a few more things. So I think, you know, all those things will, you know, we'll have to keep watching. But I believe that, you know, the rising liquidity level globally and whatever, you know, incremental has been done in India, that also will help us understand, I mean, sort of come out of this crisis. Of course, markets can, you know, be volatile in the shorter term, so you can never make out because of many factors, which I will discuss just in a few minutes. So what's next from here? I think, you know, it is very clear that every crisis brings pain. It also ends always, and it brings opportunity. So, you know, we have already seen a huge amount of pain. There's no question on that. Crisis will also end. All of us asking this question, when? And I think, you know, and what are the new opportunities? And that is where we should spend a lot of time at this point in time. It's very important to keep that every crisis, when it unfolds, it is always usually followed by a second order or third order effect. What are these? Let us look at some of the historical examples. In 1929, when the Great Depression happened, in the first year, 700 banks failed. But in next few years, another 9,000 banks failed. Of course, a very different long subject that why it happened, because that time the approach of the Fed and government was very different than in the subsequent crisis. But point is that, you know, that one crisis led to many more, you know, crises after that. Second order effect, third order effect applied depending on what the solutions were found. Even siege of World War II was sown at the time of 1929 crisis. If I would look at the same thing at the tech bubble time, I think Enron, Arthur Anderson collapse, all those things, you know, happened that point in time. In India, back home, I think we saw Ketan Parekh scam, Badla got banned, UTI Unit 64 fiasco happened, post.com bubble. So all those things were, you know, once the crash happened, second order effect, third order effect of main crisis was there. Likewise, I can say in case of 2008-09 crisis, you know, we had GFC when, you know, after there was a huge amount of backlash against the Wall Street, populism came. Even if you see, you know, everywhere populism started becoming, you know, very, very, very famous. Every successive government has used that sentiment to come back to the power, you know, whether it is US, whether it is India or anywhere else in the world. Compliance regulatory burden went up. We saw General Motors, you know, failing post that. We saw, you know, so a lot of, and also we also saw our post the balance sheet of US household getting repaired. That was on the positive side. As I was saying that before the crisis, there was a almost 50%, 1.5 times leverage of the US household, which has now, you know, net saving of about 7-8%. So that happened post-crisis. Right? Same thing in India, we had populism. We had also Satyam scandal coming out, you know, in January 2009. Crisis had happened in September 2008. So after 2-3 months, when the things started getting back, Satyam scandal had kind of gone. So there's always possibility of those, you know, second order effect, which kind of creates volatility and uncertainty in the market. In the current context also, we might have some second order effect, third order effect. Some of them we have seen, negative crude oil price, we couldn't have thought any ever before. You know, closure of Franklin Templeton Fund, who thought that a COVID will lead to closure of a mutual fund funds, right? So, you know, these are the things which will come out, and many more can come out. We do not know, because we live in a very complex, intertwined, interlinked world, globally as well as different linkages are there in different parts of the economy, world, globe. So those things will happen. Now, there could be many more coming out. We could see a geopolitical situation. We could see, you know, some global institutional mechanism like WHO, WTO, UN falling, the kind of noises, rhetorics are being made. I don't know whether they are election-oriented rhetorics or general, you know, a trend where this could, you know, stay here for some more time and can degenerate into collapse of some of the institutions which has been existing since World War II. That can happen. You know, we can probably have the deglobalization getting accelerated. We can see seeds of next pandemic getting sown here. There could be some currency order change, you know. So many more, I mean, can oil price coming down end to an radicalization, which happens from a particular part of the world. So all those things are quite possible. Coming back to India, we can think about, you know, can there be banking fall? Can there be, you know, sort of some sort of political fallout of this? Commercial real estate, you know, a lot of talk is happening about work from home. Can you see some sort of derating, you know, slow down in the sort of correction in the prices of that? So we don't know yet. All I'm saying, these are not the things I'm saying they will happen. This is just, you know, kind of running your imagination wide, saying what can happen. And when you kind of think a lot of things, at least it keeps you open to various, you know, possibilities. It keeps you open to understand what are the various possibilities, to understand what are these you know, events and what their likely impact on markets and economy, because they will create some impact. And hence, I believe that post-crisis, if you see 3 to 6 months period, is always a volatile, uncertain period. You see recovery, you see correction, you see again recovery, you see correction. And that kind of, you know, kind of mood, sentiment continues, because markets are kind of trying to find out whether this is over, this is not over. There's always confusion. So I can, you know, the classic example I give is that post-global financial crisis, you know, crisis happened in September, and market started coming back in October, November after the stimulus. And January 2009, Satyam crisis happened. And again, Indian market got sold off big time. It got sold off by 20%. And in March 2009, it bottomed out. But in March 2009, I must tell you that, you know, most mutual funds, or many mutual funds, were sitting on 25% cash, which essentially tells you that even, you know, smartest investor at that point in time had no faith in the recovery, no faith in that, despite all the stimulus talk and all those things, recovery, that markets will come back. Otherwise, they won't be sitting on cash. But at the same time, from March 2009 to October 2018, 18 months time, Nifty went up 2.4 times from 2,600 to 6,000. 2.4 times. And I will talk about a little bit more on detail on this later. But this is the kind of, you know, return happened when everybody was, or most people were kind of bearish or not clear about the direction of the market. So, you know, data points will always be following. You will never see data points coming through in the economy, right? Markets always tend to lead, you know, and there are various, you know, sort of data points. If you see global auto sales, always, you know, it's a very, very, very great correlation between with a 6 months lag of the US money supply or global liquidity cycle vis-a-vis, you know, auto cycle picking up. And there are various data points on, you know, one can say, so the real improvement happens with the lag. So if I were to kind of, you know, juxtapose or reimagine the same thing in this context, we will see a lot of data points only improving with the lag. And by then market would have made their hypothesis, market would have made their, and hence, you know, and in this period, there could be some volatility, markets can come off because there are a lot of adjustments being made. You know, some development happens, let's say Indo-China border, some developments are happening. You know, there could be some more escalation of US-China around, you know, election, because November we have election. So all those things are quite possible and that will keep markets, you know, volatile. But it is also very important to know that these are the 3 to 6 months period of the volatile market when the faith is very low. They also form the bedrock of the bull market, and that people who invest into this period come out very strong. Or if you take 24 months, 36 months, and you know some of the charts which we are, I have here, it shows that obviously falls are very, you know, in every crisis, every whether you look at global financial crisis, if you were to look at here, you know, markets fell 61%, but over next, different time period, in 6 months, they were up 90%. In 12 months, they were up 107%. In 12 months, in 24 months, they were up about 126%. So in every time, you know, there has been good, decent bounce back over a period of 6 to 24 months. And that is, I think, essential to keep in mind that, and you can go back to look at any crisis. You know, it has sort of come out. And some of these charts are there, you know, picking up from different times that how long it took, you know, to recover. You know, from the bottom. So all those things are kind of a lot of data points which are there. Which are the sectors which outperform? You know, again, this I'm talking about purely from the historical experiences, historical data points, you know, in different crises. In global financial crisis, I mean, what 18 month data point I was talking about, which is not here, but I'll just, that when the Nifty went up 2.4 times, banking index went up 3.4 times. Auto index went up 3.5 times. Real estate index went up almost close to 3.2, 3.3 times. So, you know, metals, I think, did very well, almost close to 3.5 times. So, and in within that, many stocks went up 5x, 6x, 7x. Bajaj Finance, I remember, did 12 times. LIC Housing Finance, I think, did about 6, 7 times. Many of the stocks, you know, did very well, much more than the market and index, as we know that, you know, index is a total of many stocks. So I think we must keep in mind that this period always forms the bedrock of, you know, investing cycle. But this is the most uncertain period. This is the most unnerving period. This is the time period when you have no clarity about the data, no clarity about the future, no clarity about, you know, how it will pan out. But fact of the matter is, if you look at, you know, this everybody around the globe is trying to repair it. And when every government, every central bank is trying to repair it in the right way, and they are doing absolutely the right thing, then I think recovery comes, and it comes with a lag. And that is what I think, you know, the point is, you know, what I was trying to make. Now, here's one interesting chart I was trying to, you know, sort of, you know, so again, and I will talk a lot about this fiscal and monetary, but see, this shows that we can get into, and right now, deficits are almost around 14 to 15% in case of US and similar numbers and more in many countries case. We can have this twin fiscal and monetary expansion over next, you know, 4 or 5 years. And if that were to happen, we can get into a reasonably good bull market. It's quite possible. I am not saying it's happening, but it's quite possible that dollar will weaken over next 3-4 years and risk appetite will come back. Risk on trade might happen. And I would assign a very good probability to this happens if US continues to spend fiscally as well as monetarily. And blocks like Germany, which have, I mean, Germany is a very, very conservative country as far as the fiscal is concerned. They, by the way, you know, just before pre-COVID, they were net, you know, fiscal surplus country for long, long time. You know, I mean, we in India, we don't understand the concept of fiscal surplus, but Germany was fiscal surplus country. That kind of, you know, country has come back and say, we will expand now our fiscal deficit. We will spend so that the demand revival happens. So we have a very good chance, I would say, that very high probability of over next 3 to 4 years, you know, getting into a very reasonably good cycle, you know, of the liquidity, which will feed into the economic growth of the global GDP and global demand. Low interest rates, I think everybody knows that, you know, we have huge, I mean, globally low interest rates. There, India also interest rates are coming sharply down. So low interest rates is a very good scenario for equity as an asset class. So, you know, and I think interest rates are likely to remain low at least for next 3-4 years and before the Fed start getting back to normalcy, you know, start unwinding their balance sheet. But at least 3-4 year scenario is likely to be fairly decent. Other interesting thing, I think, which is there, I think, especially from Indian context perspective, I feel that, you know, this whole, you know, supply chain backlash against China, I think every country is trying to diversify away their base as much as they could. So India could be obvious beneficiary of this. And even what is happening on India-China border, you know, I am reasonably sure that, you know, some amount of our domestic imports also will reduce, and a lot of money promotion will happen for the manufacturing in our country. It will not happen overnight. It will happen, you know, it's a beginning of a trend, you know, and we should not underestimate to see a trend. I think, and trend typically pans out over 5-10 years, but this is a trend we must keep in mind. I know that this is a very big moment for India's manufacturing, whether we will capture it or not, that only time will say, but right now most stars seems to be aligned to see that, you know, India is, you know, can capture this moment. Fortunately, rural economy is holding on very well. It has the least impact on that. Normal monsoons are predicted. So I hope that, you know, that side is giving us reasonably good cushion. Another important positive for India is that lower commodity prices, it helps us because we are net importer of commodities, and including oil, especially the oil, and which helps us. I haven't seen in my career when current accounts surplus month, you know, which was recently the case. So, you know, that's a very good news, and we are sitting on a record, you know, our reserve. So I think that gives huge amount of comfort. And valuation also is, you know, reasonably comfortable, I would say. Some of the numbers probably might have to change because, you know, they were taken about 3 weeks back. But, you know, it's not materially changing, to be very frank. But, you know, we are not far away from, you know, many bottoms in the past, whether it is price to book, price to earning, you know, or market cap to GDP, if you were to look at. So if the cycle plays out, I think, you know, the risk reward right now is pointing out towards, you know, allocating more capital towards equities. Of course, you know, you have the time to invest in the next 3 to 6 months. Not, you know, I'm not saying that in a day one has to deploy, but there will be volatility moments. There will be uncertain times in this next 3 to 6 months period. And that kind of one should use is, that will not be the time to be fearful. That will be the time to kind of use the opportunity, in my opinion. We must ask risk before investing, because risk should never be undermined. Risk can come from the factors, so various sources you can't even imagine, and they always surprise you. So we should always keep imagining and reimagining what are the possible risks. Geopolitical tension could be a very big risk. We don't know what kind of escalation can happen. Currency war, again, could be a very big risk. Like second order effect we discussed in previous slides, they can, any of them playing out can have an impact on the markets for sure. If second wave of COVID happens, which we are seeing in some sense in different parts of the world, and it could happen in India as well, so that risk is you know, material and real. And we have a very vulnerable banking sector. The RBI is doing whatever it takes to kind of support that. But at the same time, we can't wish away the fact that our banking sector is not one of the strongest, and hence it needs to be recapitalized. It needs to be sort of handled well. And anything wrong, any one misjudgment, miscalculation, you know, can degenerate into. So you have to be very, very careful on that. And I must say that RBI is doing everything, you know, including moratorium, you know, restructuring some of the loans. And it's doing everything what it takes, in my opinion. And, you know, while there could be always more, but So banking sector could be sort of at risk. So we have to be watchful of those factors, you know, while we are investing. So I think, you know, I will probably, you know, said that, you know, summarize and then, step back and, you know, go back to Kamal for questions. But just, you know, markets, you know, will be volatile. Mild inflation is good for equities as an asset class. We might see some amount of inflation, not immediately, but maybe, you know, 1 year down the line, 2 years down the line, you know, but that's not bad. USD weakness could spur a big wave of emerging market and risk on trade. Gold is likely to do well given the amount of money printing which has happened. Gold always does well when this kind of printing happens. And in this cycle, some of the trends will be, you know, many weak businesses will get out of the, or companies will get out of the business. Big will become bigger. They will be able to get garner a lot more market share, become stronger. Technology will play a very big role in everything what we do, including precisely what we are doing. So I think all those things will be very, very important to see. And we'll have to constantly keep these big trends, macro trends in mind to decide our overall, you know, sort of investing strategy. Data, as I was saying, data point will be mixed. We will not get complete clear data point about, you know, recovery. There will be mixed data points, some positive, some negative, but market always looks ahead. So, you know, but as I was saying, money invested during uncertain times generates sort of decent returns. So good plan is to do SIP over a long period of time. Yeah. And this is my final favorite saying that, you know, the only certainty is that there's no certainty. We will always have, you know, uncertain times. We'll always have mixed information, but we have to make every decision you take has a consequences with the keeping in mind probabilities. So, and we have to act, we have to decide. Not taking action is not an, you know, is also an act. Actually, not deciding is also a decision. So you have to, you know, sort of whatever it is. I mean, one is not saying that you have to invest into equities, not equities, but, you know, when there is a fuzzy environment, still you have to make something out of it and decide. And, you know, judgment, we need to judge the decision, not only based on the results, but, you know, what is the quality of input which went. And that's how I always say people that make unemotional decisions, make keep the, you know, objective decisions making at the fore, not get carried away by the emotions and the negativity around that. If you take fear and emotions away and be objective, I think everybody can find a lot of sense out of the current uncertain environment. Is my view. So, you know, Kamal, I hope this is a quick summary I thought I will leave your audience with, and I would be very happy to sort of, you know, take any questions you might have.
Yeah, there are a lot of questions. So, you know, it has been a very enriching session from you. Thank you so much, Vikas, for that. So the first question is, you know, that for last 10 years, Indian equity markets have not been kind of, you know, giving very euphoric returns. So if we, you know, talk about numbers, 2010 Sensex was a level of 20,000, and then, you know, 2020 it is around 35,000. So it's up by, say, 60%. In line with, you know, Sensex and Nifty giving around 60% returns, many PMSs and mutual funds have also kind of given similar kind of returns, or you know, that comes to a CAGR of around 5-6% returns. And in dollar terms, it is all the more lower because at the same time, Indian, you know, currency has got, you know, depreciated versus dollar. So, the, you know, last 10 years, a lot of things have happened. And especially in last 3 years, it was a pre-COVID, pre-crisis, pre, you know, era. But now we are in the crisis. A lot of things have changed. A lot of things have become all the more worrisome. So what is the, you know, what are the factors that you see which look now different or look now fundamentally positive for somebody who really, you know, wants to invest for next 10 years. Having said that, right, last 10 years, you know, if the basically, you know, the in nutshell, investors kind of have lost their confidence on equity as an asset class because of the patience of last 10 years, and hence this question. Now over to you.
Sure, Kamal, I think it's a very good question. I think very, very, you know, relevant question. Please understand, I think while yes, at the index level, markets have given very poor return over the last 10 years. But at the same time, in this 10 years only, we have had companies, we have had, many companies, especially in the index, which have given superior returns. I mean, look at companies like HDFC Bank has given 20% return, Kotak Bank has given 20% return, you know, companies like Titan, Hindustan Lever, Nestle's are in the range of 18-19%. We have had Eicher Motor giving 33% return CAGR. We have had, you know, many companies which have given very, very decent return. So idea is to actually, if you ask me, not necessarily look at only at the index level of investing. And I feel that India is a market where active management plays a very big role. There's a serious opportunity to create alpha. Unfortunately, what has happened in our markets also in the last 5 years specifically, I think 2014 onwards, we had actually expected a strong recovery and markets would have done very well. But we have had, you know, three big shocks to the system, one after another. I mean, it started with the demonetization. If you see predominant demonetization, economy was kind of chugging along very well, growing very well, and we were all kind of predicting a very good outcome. So demonetization happened. Then I think successive year, we had GST implementation, which created disruption. And following year after that, we had big IL&FS crisis, which was a, in my opinion, I always call it a Lehman crisis, or Lehman crisis of India. But we did not do what US did in case of Lehman crisis. We had no such measures to sort of counter the impact of that. So, you know, and India, I mean, and then now we have COVID crisis. So unfortunately, in the last 5 years, we've been, you know, facing one or other crisis, one after another. And that not only weakened our banking system, but also weakened, because banking system is actually, you know, bloodline of, you know, everything. So it has also had an impact on the businesses. So as a result of that, wherever we needed investment, our investment cycle went for a toss. So wherever we needed investments, it couldn't happen. So, you know, we were only living on a consumption-driven demand, which was also being backed by not more job creation, but by the, I think, freebies of the government and, you know, so I think, you know, to that extent, we saw that happening. But I do believe that, you know, some of the factors will not change though, but I do believe that, you know, this crisis could unleash investment cycle in India. But it will not happen overnight. But as I was saying, manufacturing activity can pick up. Government is right now a lot more proactive and open to encourage businesses to, start looking at manufacturing new places. They've done labor reforms. They're doing land reforms. And at state level, I'm told, you know, many states like Andhra Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, they are kind of going out to businesses and, you know, allocating lands so that they can set up the businesses. So I think we might be surprised if, you know, and this crisis could be very big catalyst for India. Having said that, you know, even if India, if you see, there was a sort of, if you see, I had a chart which I kind of didn't show, but I'll show you that if you look at this chart, you know, over the years, if you look at India has delivered, you know, it's not that India has not delivered. I mean, we have had our crisis. India is always volatile. Something other keeps coming. But if you look at a fairly long period of time, India delivers. So I think, you know, yes, last 5 years have been exceptionally low. And if you look at point to point, it looks pretty weak. But I think, you know, if you calculate this return, maybe pre-COVID, it would have shown a little different picture than what it is showing now. And if you did this probably in March, it would have shown zero returns, over 10-year cycle. So sometimes this point to point and, you know, index level comparison might not give the right picture. I know for sure that a lot of people have created wealth in this, market only over the last 10 years. Of course, people who got into mid-cap cycle over the last 2-3 years have kind of destructed also a lot of wealth. So idea is that if you get your, you know, portfolio strategy right, you know, two things I think investors must do in my mind. You know, get the asset allocation right. And, you know, and then, you know, within that, once you get the asset allocation, because a large part of the money is made through right asset allocation. And once you've done the asset allocation, then I think, you know, getting the right investment, opportunity, whether it is company or businesses which you are investing into, that determines large part of the return. So two things are very, very important. And I feel that, India is on its great trajectory, whether we like it or not, despite all these crises, what we have been going through in last, look at this, you know, last 20, since 2001 to 2020, 20 years, all possible crises have happened, right? All possible crises, global financial crisis to COVID to, you know, Brexit to, you know, geopolitical situation, local scams, local everything, demon, everything has happened. Despite that, our GDP is almost 6 times of what it was in 2000. Now, in this period, you know, we have had many organizations getting created. We have always had unemployment problem. We have always had, you know, bureaucracy problem. All banking sector always have had those, right? But despite that, I think, you know, because, you know, key reason is that India is a young country. The sheer productivity, whatever, you know, even if it is suboptimal, you know, we will be productive, and you know, we will consume, we will invest, we will you know, so those basic level of, you know, things will happen. And if you take, you know, GDP is going to go to $5 trillion, and which is a mathematical number. All you can argue is whether it will go into 25, 26 or 27. That is a matter of argument. It is not a matter of argument that it will go there or not. It will go there. Now, question is that if that were to happen, and if you were to take market cap to GDP at any benchmark, take historical, you know, period, you know, between, it varies between 0.5 to 1.5, depending on the bull or bear cycle. Now, even if you take a mid-cycle of 1x, you will see market cap of India getting closer to $5 to $6 trillion. And today we are sub $2 trillion. So you will see between $3 to $4 trillion of absolute wealth getting created over the next 5 to 7 years. I mean, I don't have any doubt in that. Okay, I will assign a very low probability of that happening. If that were to happen, now, you know, only investors would participate in that opportunity, right? So equity only will participate in that opportunity. Of course, many more asset classes will also come. But, you know, I think we are in a very good cycle where India's demography at its play. We are most under leveraged country in the world, whether it is corporate level or at the country level, whatever, most under leveraged country. So we have that leverage cycle still to play out, and it will play out over next, you know, 5-7 years. So as we, because our banking sector, you know, will come out of the woods at, you know, some point in time, not this year, next year, you know, it cannot remain like this for long, right? Otherwise economic recovery is impossible. Once that comes out, so you will see huge amount of wealth getting created over next, you know, 5-7 years. So I do believe that, you know, looking at sometimes this point-to-point index or sometimes only index and deciding on equity allocation probably can give you a misleading picture. And also equity investing is about you know, forward-looking than really, real view. And I would say that I am quite optimistic in terms of opportunity as a wealth creation opportunity in India over the next 5-7 years.
Right. So the second question pertains to understanding the relevance of market cap to GDP ratio. So it's an academic question. Basically, you know, a lot of data points are floating around by a lot of asset management companies comparing the ratio of market cap to GDP in 2008 versus today. Right, in 2008 used to be around 140%, and today in current context it is shown as around 65 to 70%. So what is the relevance of this ratio?
So this is an indicative ratio. It is not that it's the gospel truth or it's a Bible, that this is, it is just, it's like this any other indicator that, you know, if GDP growth is a relevant indicator, you know, because GDP growth at the end of the estimation, right? So what it basically tells you, see, overall collective market cap of the country, and as the GDP progresses, you know, obviously it will have impact on the market cap of the company. We know that, you know, it is old saying that Sensex is a barometer of economy, right? Now, this ratio depends on country to country. So hence, comparing one country to other country may not be very relevant, but comparing to the historical data of that country is very important, because if, let us say, some economy is more privatized, you will see this ratio far better than, let's say, countries where it is not privatized. Let's say something like China, where, you know, lot is state-owned, lot is state-controlled, this ratio may not be as relevant. But, you know, India is, I would like to believe, is a fairly open economy. The state-owned private enterprises are much lesser. You know, not many enterprises are, most of the enterprises are public, and more are going public. So they are, so the market cap represents reasonably in a good way the economic, you know, situation or reality. So as economy improves, we have seen the economic growth brings always an impact on the market capitalization, right? So it's like this, again, you look at any ratio, you can look at, you know, price to book, you can look at price to earning, they're all estimation, they're all indication. So all, when you look at the historical ranges, you typically tend to see that during the time of bear market or bearish sentiment or negative sentiments or crisis, they will tend to go to a lower level. And in the times of euphoria and bull market, they will tend to go to a particular level. And if you plot that, you know, euphoria versus bear market, crisis over a 20, 30, 40 year period, you will see, you will broadly get a range. Now, can that range be broken? Of course, it can be broken either side. You know, like in 2000, this range, by the way, market cap to GDP ratio before that, you know, was around 0.3. But there was a big shift which happened after 2000 when, you know, huge amount of infrastructure happened in the investment happened in the infrastructure, telecom, and that made a very big material impact on the economic development of the country. And post that, I think, you know, we had a material change. The whole and of course, the SEBI deregulation helped. You know, a lot of companies went public. So all those things had a huge impact on the market cap to GDP ratio. But one should take it only as an indication. This is not something like, you know, at this particular ratio you must invest and you at this particular ratio you must sell. This is just a broader indication of the sentiment comparing to the historical data.
Right. So liquidity is driving the current rally, more or less. You know, you have also mentioned this, and there are the this liquidity is you know, once in a while, if we are in unprecedented times, the measures taken by world central banks are also kind of uncomparable to last events, and hence liquidity, you know, is real, and these are driving the prices. And in our last webinar, Mr. Bharat Shah also mentioned that liquidity driving the prices is the fundamental phenomena of any economy. It is the economic truth that prices are driven by liquidity. So what are your views in this regard? So how sustainable is this? As you took an example of a small business where you said that if working capital is given, business will be able to recover. But at the same time, if there is no demand coming out, you know, how long will that working capital requirement or liquidity continue to drive?
Correct. So first of all, I think we must understand that this question of no demand, it does not exist, you know, in my opinion. You know, just think, look around that, you know, have we stopped consuming? You know, we might have stopped consuming on travel, I mean, spending on travel. We might have stopped, spending on, you know, few going out and, you know, shopping certain things. But we have not stopped, I think, you know, consuming at least 50-60% of what we were doing, right? So consumption will never get over. Of course, as the lockdown opens up, those you know, shopping and, you know, going out also will start opening up slowly. But till the time, I think so, certain part of the economy will open up. And as the economic recovery happens, demand will, you know, in my opinion, start coming in. So somewhere, Kamal, what happens is always convergence happens. You know, market leads, liquidity kind of goes up, and you know, it feeds into economic growth. And as it feeds into economic growth, both converges. And again, please understand, let us say, this is also a matter of fact that even if, let us say, when the asset prices are down, my risk appetite, my mood to spend is lower. And when the asset prices are decent, my wealth effect allows me to sort of spend also, because I become a lot more comfortable, a lot more. And that plays out at every individual level. Even if when the markets are doing well, even corporates try to take more risk. When they are not doing well, corporates kind of hold back. So this is a very natural cycle. Historically, if you see, you know, liquidity first drives the asset prices, but eventually economic converges. But in between, that's the reason historically, any crisis you see, wherever there's a big amount of liquidity flush has happened, it has come back fast. But go back to 1929, that time the Fed, you know, took the stance that let's not spend, let's unwind. They cut down government spending. They kind of actually, you know, big time cut down spending, and they started prophesizing that we should not spend in the economy. And what happened? You know, banks failed. What happened? Again, economy took 7 years to recover, right? Because the liquidity cycle was not there to support both revival of the demand as well as the. Today, when US is spending $2.5 trillion giving money in the hands of users, you know, individuals, they are going to consume. And the US retail pickup is showing a very decent encouraging sign. As they pick up, and you know, you will start seeing, you know, supply side, business side, everything responding to that, and businesses coming back. The point I was mentioning, that between global liquidity cycle and auto sales picking up globally, there's a 6 months lag. Now this lag will play out even this time around. I see no reason, and this explains that why this lag, you know, feeds into demand creation, and you know, it eventually happens. Because the money is going into pockets of people. So I believe that this convergence will play out over next 6 to 12. And when I'm saying this, I'm not making a point that tomorrow market cannot correct by 5-7%. And I'm not making that point. So let me, you know, not, you know, create a wrong impression that market can be volatile in a shorter term for any reason. But when I'm talking about, you know, directionally, I think economy is directionally much positive.
Right. So what is the context that you're trying to make when you're saying India relatively is an under-leveraged country?
Yeah. So if you look at our corporate debt to GDP ratio, if you look at our overall country debt to GDP, we are in last 10 years we have not had our credit cycle. I wish I had the chart. I could have shown you. We had done some charts some time ago where India on the leverage stands out. Most emerging markets are far more leveraged than India. Our debt to GDP is I think about 45 or 50%, which is I think very very low for a country which needs to grow and makes investment. Actually, our credit cycle has not played out, unfortunately, and we need to play that outside. And again, we had a play out of the credit cycle between 2009 to 2014, though in a wrong way, which eventually come back has hounded us. But that credit cycle had fed into the markets, right? So because a lot of corruption happened and the 2G scam, so a lot of investment cycle which played out actually created NPA in the system. So we should not have that kind of credit cycle coming again. But if we have a right credit cycle coming in, I think we have a very good runway ahead of us. Because only when the money supply grows in the country, which happens through more leverage, which happens through more supply of the money by the RBI, so M3 effect, what I'm talking about, when the M3 plays out, you will see that having a lot of impact on the GDP number and the GDP growth.
Right. So what are your views on sectors? If someone has to invest for next 5 years, what sectors are you more bullish upon?
So I think they don't change very often, unfortunately. But I feel that, I think banking and financial services will do well. There's no story of India without the revival in the banking and financial services, because that's a large part of the economy. Without recovery of that, so I think it will play out, in my opinion, over the next 3 to 5 years. We will see many more banks. Again, go back to GFC. Most banks got sold off there, but they ended up creating again a huge amount of wealth post any period. So I think that is the one sector I feel. And fortunately, we have a fairly wide range now as compared to historical times when we had only banks. But now we have entire financial services range in terms of asset management, insurance, general insurance, life insurance. Many more options are there. I think that is good news. Consumption, I think India's per capita income is likely to grow. I am very bullish on consumer discretionary rather than consumer staple, because I think consumer discretionary is going to sort of do well. Right now, they don't look good because of, again, no data. So, automobiles and a lot of other consumer discretionary don't look good. But I do believe that it's good time to take a bet on some of them where they are available at a reasonable valuation. Good balance sheet. Of course, you must invest into good balance sheet and good businesses, not weak balance sheets and weak businesses. But then you are taking a risk of individual company not surviving. But in that, very, very good companies, good balance sheet, I think, that sector, consumer discretionary, I would bet a lot. Even I think, manufacturing side, I was saying that, in India can pick up very well. You will see positive sentiment around that. Manufacturing historically has never been seen kindly by the markets because they don't generate returns or they require a lot of investments. But this view is changing. We have not many companies, but we have few companies like India's largest air conditioner manufacturer, some of the electronic items manufacturer, and there are many more in the sense. But, pure manufacturers will start, I think, being regarded, and, because the growth will be huge. So you will see that part, I think, doing pretty well. Select pockets of investment cycle can also do well. Like I feel that because of this huge liquidity, global cyclicals like metals can do very well, and we have seen after every crisis metals come out one of the strongest, and that is quite possible. One cannot rule that out in that sense. So I feel that that's the one cycle one can play out. Real estate, I'm not sure at this point in time, it might take some time to play out. But yeah, these are some of the broader sectors, which will do well. But I always believe that more than looking at the sectors, only, one should, of course, look at broader tailwinds of the sector, but it is always better to look at, companies and businesses and managements in that, that's the right strategy, according to me, rather than looking at only pure sectoral allocation.
Right. So final remarks from you with regards to, your piece of advice to investors during these times, and then we will end.
So I think, Kamal, very simply, I think, I believe that everybody is fearful. And there's an old saying that, you should be greedy when others are fearful, and you should be, fearful when others are greedy. Right now, we all know that everybody is fearful. And whenever, you know, there is a fear, it obviously creates panic. It all obviously creates the risk, sense of the risk. Right now, the risk perception is very high. So what happens is the reward per unit of risk you take is highest. But unfortunately, you end up taking the least risk on that. So when the reward per unit of risk is lowest, you end up taking the most risk, because that time the environment is very conducive, everybody talking positive, there's some data to support, but suddenly this comes from nowhere, right? So because risk is always there, you know, there's no question on that, you know, I'm not saying risk is not, but the reward per unit of risk is right now, in my opinion, you know, or amid any crisis, but you know, even this crisis is very high. And, you know, I feel that we will come out of this. So be objective. Don't be fearful. Look at data, and you know. And if you can't control your fear, panic, then you know, stay away. You don't need to do something in this. But you know, if you can, you know, follow the right strategy of the asset allocation. Be objective. Be fearful. Be very, very rational about your thinking. And I feel, you know, if you follow that, you know, you should be able to come out from a longer term perspective. You should be prepared that if you put in money today, tomorrow it can go down 10%. You should be prepared with that. If you might put, so you know, if that is the case, you can stagger it out. My advice would be stagger it out over the next 3 to 6 months. I think calendar 2020 is one of the best year to put money. We will all look back in hindsight, like how we looked at it, you know, calendar 2008. Many times we look at, oh my God, that was such a great opportunity to buy. How, you know, stupid we could be. These are the kind of conversations people had for a long, long time after the crisis. So I think probably 2020 will be very much similar to 2008, and we will see, you know, fairly positive outcome of, you know, and of wealth creation. So I would say that, you know, but you must then keep your risk in mind, your individual risk profile in mind. You know, so I'm not, you know, advising blanket to everyone that you must do. You must keep your own particular, your need of cash flow in mind, your time horizon in mind before you allocate money. But you must allocate to equity in my opinion.
You know, this reminds me, when we did our event on 7th February, you were also there. The topic of that event was crystal gazing next decade of wealth creation. So, you know, drivers were all there at that point of time, but levels were higher. And now, you know, levels are low. And maybe, as you said, there could be second level of, you know, challenges and third level of challenges, and hence volatility could continue. So the remaining part of this year, which is the three more quarters, 9 months, you know, are a fundamental opportunity for investors to eventually invest with the horizon of next decade. So with these remarks, you know, I would like to thank everyone for joining on this enriching webinar. Thank you, Vikas, for your views.
Thank you, Tom.